welcome to what I'm confident will be a fascinating discussion about three gripping and important books. John Farrell's Richard Nixon, The Life, Will Hitchcock's The Age of Eisenhower, America and the World in the 1950s, and Sharon Weinberger's The Imagineers of War, The Untold Story of DARPA, the Pentagon Agency that Changed the World. I'm Clark Coit, your moderator, and I want to welcome everyone on behalf of Virginia Humanities, producer of the Virginia Festival of the Book. Today we're going to discuss two presidential biographies and the history of a fascinating agency created on the watch of one of those presidents. The authors will give us brief synopses of their books. We'll then have a discussion up here and finally open it for questions from you, the audience. First up is William Hitchcock, a professor of history at the University of Virginia and the Randolph P. Compton Professor at UVA's Miller Center. He received his undergraduate degree from Kenyon College and his PhD from Yale University. Before coming to UVA, Will taught at Yale, Wellesley College, and Temple University, where he was chair of the history department. His 2008 book, The Bitter Road to Freedom, A New History of the Liberation of Europe, was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize. Will, tell us about The Age of Eisenhower. Your book was just published this week.
Yes, indeed. Thank you, Clark, and thanks to all of you for being here. Thanks to my really distinguished co-panelists. It's great to be here. So here's the question. Why should any of us care about Dwight Eisenhower? Well, I have a book here to answer that question. The book makes the argument that Dwight Eisenhower, who, of course, may seem as if he's a figure from a very different era than ours, is actually one of the most consequential presidents of the post-war era. Now, a lot of scholars and academics would howl with laughter at that assertion. Well, I have a book to show them. Eisenhower had a significant impact on the shape of modern America since World War II. And I argue in the book, in many ways, we're still, in a funny way, living in the age of Eisenhower in certain respects. And that's what I try to make the case in the book, that he really shaped the evolution and development of the United States. Now, I'll just give you three big themes, ways in which he did that. The first major way in which Ike shaped modern America was that he helped to build, and really to legitimate, the warfare state. The warfare state is in fact the military-industrial complex that Eisenhower warned us about on his way out of office. But Eisenhower did a great deal to build it. He expanded the Pentagon, he expanded the Defense Department, he spent huge sums of money on new technologies, whether it was the U-2 spy plane or the Corona satellite or a variety of other things that Sharon will tell us about. He invested an enormous amount of money and prestige in waging the Cold War and in the tools that were required to wage and ultimately to win the Cold War. So whether you like it or not, the fact is that he really bulked up our ability to wage a global Cold War against the Soviet Union. So in that one aspect, he was enormously consequential. He invested his prestige as well as a great deal of money into building the strength that would go on to win the Cold War. The second thing I think he's significant for is that he really significantly shaped the Republican Party and American politics, because what did Eisenhower do on the domestic side? He created a political space on the center of the political spectrum, neither right nor left. He ran to the center, and he popularized the idea that you could be a centrist and still be a successful politician in America. Hard to believe. That's not the world we live in now. Though I believe, actually, that many Americans still wish and hope that we could somehow return to a somewhat more centrist set of debates and discussions in our political life. That's not where politicians live. They live on the margins. Eisenhower pulled the Republican Party out of its isolationist camp and brought it into an internationalist camp. So he shaped the Republican Party in his own time. And he also worked across the aisle to create a kind of vital center in the 1950s. So in that sense, he also had an impact on domestic politics and public life. The last thing I'll say, because we're just giving you a few themes to discuss, we'll come back to these in the Q&A. The third big thing I think he offers us. Eisenhower gave us a model for what presidential leadership actually might look like. And this is something I think that still resonates, of course, across the country, and I know this because I've talked to a lot of people about Eisenhower. The term that I use in the book is, he gave us a model for the disciplined presidency. Discipline in the White House is actually a huge advantage. And of course, he was a military officer, so he knew something about discipline. But I don't just mean that he could go down and do a one-arm push-up, which I don't think he could when he was president. But nonetheless, what I mean by that is he used the tools of government very effectively because he understood how the bureaucracy worked. And he was disciplined in pursuing a limited number of important objectives. Balanced budget, defense spending, and infrastructure. He said he would do that when he got into office. He did it for 8 years, and guess what? He got results in all three. That's being disciplined. Meeting with the cabinet, meeting with the National Security Council, meeting with the Congress, and meeting with the press. He did that every single week. So he was a focused man, and he got results. So I think he gives us an interesting model about how presidents could actually be more effective, even in a time like ours, which seems so chaotic. So I think he's a man for our times, and like it or not, we all still live in the age of Eisenhower.
We're going to lead into it, but let me introduce you first. Sharon Weinberger is executive editor at Foreign Policy Magazine. Previously, she was national security editor at The Intercept, where she directed the publication's defense and intelligence coverage. She's a graduate of Johns Hopkins University and holds master's degrees from the University of Pittsburgh's School of Public and International Affairs and from Yale in Russian and East European Studies. She's held numerous reporting fellowships, and her writing has appeared in the New York Times and the Washington Post, among many publications. So tell us about DARPA, Sharon.
So I was pretty happy about being invited on this specific panel, because usually when I've spoken about the book, I start with kind of what I think are some of the more amusing stories of DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. So whether it was the time that DARPA, during the Vietnam War, sent a psychologist to give a Rorschach test to an imprisoned Viet Cong fighter, or the time that DARPA had a top secret program to zap monkeys with microwaves to see if it could be a mind control weapon. And those episodes illustrate something real about Cold War and science, but I have not yet, although I talk about it a lot in the book, talked about the relationship between Eisenhower and the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. So I'm going to start by talking just a little bit about what this agency is. I think that Nixon and Eisenhower are well known. DARPA, for some people, is a household name. For a lot of people, it isn't. So DARPA was created in February 1958, and it was personally authorized by Eisenhower as a response to the launch in October 1957 of Sputnik, the world's first artificial satellite, which was launched by the Soviet Union. There's a little bit of mythology that has developed around Sputnik. It was a big deal at the time, but the idea that it created instantly a collective panic, I think, is overplayed. It was, in many ways, a politically engineered crisis in Washington. And in part, that was the way that Eisenhower responded to it, which was very non-sensational. For the American public, it represented two things. First, that symbolically the Soviet Union had beat the United States into space. And second, that the ability to launch a satellite into space was linked to the technology to launch an intercontinental ballistic missile. So the idea of sort of the continental invincibility of the United States had been breached. Bombers might take hours and hours to reach the United States, an ICBM in under an hour. And so it was really played up in part as a political crisis. Eisenhower, in some ways, really tried to downplay it, in part because he had access to classified information the public didn't have. Eisenhower knew that the United States intelligence community was working on the first Earth imaging satellites, spy satellites, later known as Corona. That was not something revealed to the public, and that we were not as far behind as the Soviet Union was often portrayed in the press. And so administration officials really tried to downplay it. General Curtis LeMay called Sputnik just a hunk of iron. And Sherman Adams, Eisenhower's chief of staff, derided the concerns about a space race instead of a celestial basketball game of people just trying to put things up in space. But nonetheless, there was a lot of pressure on Eisenhower to do something. So what he did was he authorized the creation in 1958 of what was then known as ARPA, the Advanced Research Projects Agency. This was, in effect, the nation's first space agency. Before the creation of NASA, there was ARPA, or later what became known as DARPA, that consolidated all of the space programs into one agency. So that included Wernher von Braun, the German rocket scientists on the Army, as well as the Air Force and Navy programs. And this agency was going to get the United States into space as quickly as possible. But when DARPA was actually formed on February 7th of 1958, it was a very, very vague mandate. In fact, the agency's mandate just said this, that it's authorized to direct such research and development projects being performed within the Department of Defense as the Secretary of Defense may designate, which was anything. Eisenhower and others called this the agency that would develop the, quote, unimagined weapons of the future. And what happened very quickly was it set up in the first days of DARPA a tension that I think that Eisenhower himself created, which is, was this agency going to be a science agency that did national security, or was it a national security agency that did science? And that has been a tension in DARPA that's existed for decades and has gone back and forth. In its first year of existence, along with launching the first rockets, American rockets into space, it pursued on the science side some rather outlandish projects. Two of my favorites were, one was called Operation Argus, which was going to launch nuclear weapons, set them up in the Earth's upper atmosphere, the magnetosphere, to create a force field that would protect the entire planet from intercontinental ballistic missiles. And we're laughing about this, but those were the actual words. It's going to be a force field. So DARPA went off with the Air Force and actually launched nuclear weapons into space in a top secret mission that was, of course, leaked to the New York Times.
Things never change.
James Kelly, Eisenhower's science advisor, called it the greatest experiment ever done, and indeed it was. It was also rather unsuccessful. It turns out that the force field was going to be killer electrons from the nuclear weapons. And it turned out that the way our atmosphere is, they decayed too quickly to actually make for a force field. And DARPA's first chief scientist said, tongue-in-cheek, there could be, however, another planet, another Earth with opposing superpowers where such a shield might actually be possible. The second project that was really sort of emblematic of what DARPA was as an agency in those early days was a project called Orion, which was a conceptual spaceship that would travel to the stars powered by thermonuclear weapons. It was, well, rather unbelievable. There was a mock-up made that President Kennedy was actually, otherwise I was appalled by. It was actually 500 nuclear weapons attached to the back of it. And Freeman Dyson, one of the scientists who worked on it, said, we estimated that for every launch of this spaceship, about 10 people would die statistically on average on Earth from the fallout. On the upside, DARPA, even in those early days, did some amazing things. It paid for early work on the Saturn rocket done by Wernher von Braun and his German rocket scientists. And that rocket became, the concept of it and the model of it became what eventually launched astronauts on the first moon mission years later. Another thing that was authorized by Eisenhower personally was the first communication satellite from space, which broadcast, of course, President Eisenhower's voice. You had this mix of projects in an agency that was at war with itself and with the administration. And eventually, what actually happened was Eisenhower authorized the creation of NASA. DARPA lost the civilian space programs to this new space agency. The military satellites went back to the surfaces, and you were left, even in the days of Eisenhower, with this agency that went on to find new missions, whether it was in Vietnam, whether it was in nuclear war, and nuclear test detection. And that's much of what my book is about, is what happened to this agency after its creation by Eisenhower, where it tried to find its place in the world.
Thank you. Finally, Jack Farrell's Nixon biography reached the New York Times bestseller list and won the Pen America Prize for the best biography of 2017 and an award from the New York Historical Society as the best work in the field of American history or biography. Jack's two earlier books were about the lives of famed attorney Clarence Darrow and former House Speaker Tip O'Neill. Jack is a graduate of the University of Virginia, right here, and worked as White House correspondent, reporter on the famous Spotlight team, and Washington editor for the Boston Globe. So tell us about Nixon, Jack.
Okay, first of all, I have to compliment Jared for giving us that talk and resisting the temptation to reach forward and push one of these red buttons. It says vote, but I'm not so sure that that's it. I I sort of had the same question we faced with Eisenhower, which is why Nixon now? Mine, I think, is a little bit of an easier sell. It's not because 8 years ago I was lying in bed and I said to myself, you know, Donald Trump's going to become president. He's going to be a special counsel and a break-in at the DNC and a Saturday night massacre. It's because I thought this was a very interesting character that whose life encompassed a lot to do with my generation in particular. But I do have this feeling that somewhere in his well-deserved place in the afterlife, Richard Nixon is looking up at us. And he's saying, you see, Bob, don't miss me when I'm gone. What they have, huh? He is a caricature, and one of the things I wanted to do in the book was try to reach the man. One of the first things that I was struck by was this almost protective tenderness of the people who knew him with members of his family, and that there was a lovable human being past the Nixonian shell. And I thought that if I could portray that human being, that would be a story worth telling. He is a joke on The Simpsons. He's the only president to resign. One of the most famous and funniest stories in Washington is the day that the ex-presidents gathered at the White House to go to Anwar Sadat's funeral. And there was Gerald Ford, and there was Jimmy Carter, and there was Richard Nixon. And Bob Dole walked in and with that word of his said, see no evil, speak no evil, and evil. and the words actually, and yet, almost were part of the title to my book. And yet, with almost every bad story you tell about Richard Nixon, there is a flip side to tell about him. And in Dole's case, it was that Bob Dole went to war in 1944. He was horribly wounded in the Italian front by a mortar shell, to the point where the medic that came along wrote on Bob Dole's forehead in his own blood, you know, don't worry about this guy, we've given him all the morphine he's going to get. He's not going to make it. But Dole did make it back, and if you all remember him, he lost the use of his right arm and his shoulder. And with that, he lost the ability to perform that most basic of political functions, the handshake. And all the chambers of commerce and all the state legislatures and all the politicians in Washington that Bob Dole ever ran across, he always knew, he always said that there was one who always remembered to extend his left hand to shake his hand. And that was Richard Nixon. And if you go on YouTube now and you look at Bob Dole talking, giving the eulogy at Richard Nixon's funeral, the same man who came up with this wonderful story about seeing no evil, seeing no evil, and evil, breaks down, is racked with agony as he gives the eulogy at Nixon's funeral. So there was something more there, I thought. And yet, at one point, the working title for the book was going to be Richard Nixon, an American Tragedy, because he really was almost a Shakespearean or a figure of Greek tragedy. He did awful things in Watergate. He delayed, he undermined Lyndon Johnson's efforts to end the Vietnam War in 1968 so that he could get elected. As Mr. Spock told us when he was encouraging Captain Kirk to negotiate with the Klingons, there is an old Vulcan proverb, only Nixon can go to China. And Nixon went to China. He created with a stroke of his pen the Environmental Protection Agency. He signed the legislation that created Title IX, increasing tenfold the number of young women who were able to get athletic scholarships. The Social Security cost of living increases that some of us rely upon came into being in the Nixon administration, was signed by Richard Nixon. And he was the single most president to supervise the desegregation of Southern schools. So what to make of him? What is the lesson about Richard Nixon? I think he would say, seriously, if he was here, that he would be very dismayed at the way that we have become a polarized nation, teams tearing at each other's throats. And I say this because that last great scene in the White House before he got on the helicopter to leave Washington to go back to exile in San Clemente, where he summed up what happened to him, where he summed up his own Shakespearean tragic story. And he said, "Those who hate you don't win unless you hate them. And then you destroy yourself." And I think that's the main reason for why Nixon now. This is a cautionary tale about what can happen to good souls who destroy themselves because they give in to the baser passions of things like hate.
Thank you. I want to start Willow and Jack, two presidents who had a relationship. Nixon started as the vice president. I nearly didn't make it because of a incipient scandal, but the Checkers speech saved that relationship and it continued through two terms of Eisenhower presidency. But my sense from reading both of your books is that it was a very fraught relationship, not a close and warm one. Talk about that, each of you.
Well, the first thing I have to say, just responding to those two wonderful presentations, is Eisenhower is responsible both for DARPA and for Nixon. So, just by Trump, for better or for worse.
So you are taking credit.
Well, I am sharing. I'm just trying to get myself into the trough here. But no, the Nixon-Eisenhower relationship is endlessly fascinating. Jack has written about it in a very illuminating way. You know, Eisenhower didn't know Nixon before he met him, before Nixon had essentially been nominated by the proverbial smoke-filled room of Republican insiders who had picked Nixon to run on the ticket in 1952 because, for a lot of reasons, he was young, he was from California. Most important, he was a ferocious anti-communist, which in 1952 was a huge advantage on the Eisenhower ticket because Eisenhower was thought to be, he was a political unknown. It was known that that the Democratic Party was interested in running Eisenhower for president in 1948, maybe even in 1952. So the Republican establishment was unsure about whether or not Ike was reliable enough. So what better way than to get a hard-charging, young, dynamic senator with impeccable credentials of going after communists? Remember that Dick Nixon had unmasked the Soviet spy, Alger Hiss, made his career on it. Joe McCarthy was inspired by Nixon's political success to become Joe McCarthy in 1950. Nixon had already been there in 1948. So this was a public figure known for being tough, being hard, and Eisenhower didn't make that decision. So they met in Chicago and off they went, and the relationship really never warmed on a personal level. Now, you'll know that their families would end up being tied together by marriage between Eisenhower's grandson and Nixon's daughter. But the two men were a generation apart. They had very different world experiences. Nixon was very young when he was on the ticket, and Eisenhower was the world's most, arguably one of the most famous Americans of the century. And Eisenhower never pulled Nixon into his personal embrace, into a personal friendship. He never took him to Gettysburg, never brought him into the White House family quarters. He was just another guy on the cabinet, and by no means the most important person in the cabinet.
Yeah, I think Richard Nixon was born in the outback of California. It's always important to remember that he was Californian. That's the major reason why I picked him. The Republican Party was even then looking towards the West and the Southwest. But he had this awful blowhard of a father who was at least emotionally abusive to his sons, and he had a very reserved, cold mother who, as Nixon once famously said, "My mother never said she loved me." And he had two brothers who died, the youngest, the curly-haired brother, and then the oldest brother, sort of the favorite son of the family, died, both of them of forms of tuberculosis, ruining the family finances and making Nixon a bitter, all this left him as a bitter and insecure man. It was his insecurity which fed that tragic flaw. He was like Iago to his own Othello. He was constantly whispering in his own ear, "You're no good, they don't like you, you didn't go to Harvard, you're not handsome like Jack Kennedy, the press hates you, the press hates you, the press hates you, over and over and over again. And then he gets picked within 6 years of coming home as a lieutenant commander from the South Pacific. He goes from complete nobody to vice president of the United States. And he is a very happy guy. And he, all he wants to be is admired and be a working man of Ike's team. And you really can't fault Eisenhower. Eisenhower had just spent 5 years liberating Europe, working with Churchill and De Gaulle, all these major historic figures. And he saw Nixon as staff, as this young lieutenant who was useful to bring in a bunch of papers and put them on the desk and go somewhere else. And so it wasn't like an active disdain. It was just sort of an ignoring this guy, and he thought he was kind of quirky as he got to know him, which he was. And so Eisenhower just sort of put him off. And then Eisenhower has this heart attack. And Richard Nixon rises to the occasion and shows why it took him only 6 years to become vice president. He handles everything perfectly. He's not either too proud or too honest. He's not too brash. He's not too strong or too weak. Handles it perfectly, but in the meantime, Eisenhower has been lying in a bed, staring at the ceiling, realizes his mortality is upon him, and wonders whether or not he really wants to turn the United States of America over during the Cold War to young Richard Nixon. And despite Nixon's excellent performance, Ike comes back, resumes his duties as president, calls Nixon in and says, I don't want you on the ticket next year. And for somebody as insecure and fragile as Richard Nixon, that just shattered him. He had almost a physical breakdown. It was so bad. And so the relationship probably got better, especially after the after Dick's daughter married Ike's grandson. But there was always that feeling in there of Nixon wanting to get in to the inner circle and never getting a chance to do so.
Sharon, DARPA had its share of fascinating characters, not household names like Eisenhower or Nixon, but in reading your book, I was struck. Will talked about the disciplined president. There were a number of people, especially early in the days of DARPA, who weren't exactly disciplined, but they were fascinating characters. And you opened the book with a fellow named William Goodell. Tell us a little bit about him. I was riveted as I read about this person.
So DARPA has William Goodell's a person that's sort of been buried in history, but in fact was very close to Eisenhower and a sort of seminal figure in the intelligence world. And I hope someday that someone will write a book about him, because he has his own fascinating history, of which DARPA is an important part, but one part. So when DARPA was created in 1958, there were really three figures that were key, which says a lot about who Eisenhower was in the administration. So the first director of DARPA was a guy named Roy Johnson, who was the vice president, who had been the vice president of General Electric, and so he followed in the mold of an industrialist. And the idea being that, well, you know, it's about managing science, not necessarily science itself. So Roy Johnson was chosen as the first director, and he really thought he was going to bring, you know, men in uniform into space, that the military would control space. That part Eisenhower was not crazy about. He was listening to his science advisors who wanted a civilian space agency. So there was Roy Johnson, the industrialist. Then there was Herb York, who was a young physicist from California, very brash, very arrogant, very smart, and he was brought in as the first science director. And these are sort of the two seminal figures. And then in the background was this guy who literally, I interviewed the first administrator, the first financial administrator, who said, I have no idea where William Goodell came from. He just showed up on the initial day, and nobody said who he was or what he was doing. Well, he first headed what was called the Office of Foreign Developments. So William Goodell was sort of a famed World War II intelligence operative, and had been in Special Operations Office in the Pentagon. He had been the Pentagon's liaison to the CIA and the National Security Agency. And the reason he had been installed very quietly at DARPA was because publicly DARPA was the first space agency. What wasn't talked about was that the CIA's Earth imaging satellites, Corona, were being swept up. So Goodell was to represent the interests of the intelligence community. But he ended up being this very seminal figure, because within DARPA's first year, things started to blow up. NASA was created, they lost their civilian satellite programs. Herb York, the science director, moved over to the Pentagon, and he basically lobbied to take those space programs so he could be the space czar. So you have this agency that had been a space agency And now I have no mission. And the senior person there was William Goodell, who grows to be the deputy director. And he said, this can be kind of good for me. I mean, it good for him in terms of what he saw. He saw the conflicts in the world that, yes, nuclear apocalypse against the Soviet Union would be bad, but the more likely way that we would face off against the Soviet Union would be through proxy wars, insurgencies, such as in Southeast Asia. And he began to transform DARPA into this agency that could fulfill missions that he thought were important, which at the time included jungle warfare in Vietnam, and that's the direction that he went in. He was later sort of written out of DARPA's history because he fell out of favor with Secretary McNamara. There was an investigation. He went to jail for fraud for 4 to 5 years after Vietnam, so that became another whole history. But he was seminal in the agency.
You have to read the book for the story of how he wound up in jail, but it's quite fascinating. It's striking when you read the three books, Eisenhower and DARPA, clearly the agency founded in his time, he had great interest in it. It's a black hole. I mean, there's nothing there that I could find with Nixon and DARPA. What's the story there, Jack and Sharon?
Nixon was prepared to run for president in the late 1950s when this little silver beach ball went up called Sputnik. And it's tough to overemphasize the impact that had on the American population. A lot of the subsequent JFK, we must move further, faster, ahead with vigor, came from the shock that the Russians were beating us into space, and that's the main reason, of course, why we ended up with the moon program. And Nixon was a vocal lobbyist within the Eisenhower administration for more defense spending, for more money for rockets, for a robust American space program. And particularly when JFK, John Kennedy, and the Democrats concocted this thing called the missile gap and convinced a lot of people in the United States that the Russians were gaining a superiority in a possible nuclear war on the delivery of neutrons. And so Nixon was very much a hawk, very much willing to spend that kind of money, and yet met this resistance from Eisenhower, because Eisenhower was getting the reports from the U-2 flights, which were saying that this missile gap stuff was for the birds and that the threat was not as major as it was. When you get to the actual Nixon administration, Nixon had a way of writing off huge amounts of the government as it operated below him. He wanted to focus on his great peace initiatives, China, USSR treaties, and of course, he was consumed by Vietnam. And so a lot of these things like Title IX and others came upon his desk, defense spending, the space shuttle program, and he would sign off for them based on some political considerations at the time, but he didn't have this great thematic feel for what he wanted to do with American technology.
I think that's absolutely correct. It's funny because I dealt with most of the presidential libraries in doing research for the book, and there was really, really not much of any substance. The Nixon Library, probably is exactly like you said, I think it was just not on his radar screen. And there were also things going on that the ways in which the Nixon administration dealt with DARPA was twofold. First was DARPA had been very, very involved in the Vietnam War, which is something that had been sort of written out of its history. It was financially the third largest program in DARPA for 10 years, which they don't talk about today. And it was numerically, in terms of personnel, the biggest program in DARPA for 10 years. They were responsible for introducing chemical defoliation, Agent Orange to Vietnam, and doing some good work as well. It was a mixed bag. But the Vietnam War is winding down. DARPA's trying to get out of the conflicts abroad business and reinvent itself. And then something else happens that causes problems with the Nixon administration, which is the leak of the Pentagon Papers, which intersects with DARPA twofold. First of all, DARPA had been a big funder of RAND in those years. Daniel Ellsberg had actually had some interactions with some early DARPA. DARPA was funding RAND to do a lot of its social science work in Vietnam. But the second thing was that Nixon wanted to basically retaliate against the Defense Department, so he started cutting billets. He didn't trust the Defense Department, or at least not the Office of the Secretary of Defense. So what do bureaucracies do when under attack? They, you know, try to protect themselves. So one of the great myths of DARPA is that the D was added onto ARPA's name. It became DARPA because, you know, Nixon wanted it to focus more on defense. It's absolutely untrue. Basically, what the Pentagon did to protect billets that were being cut was they made all of these agencies independent agencies that weren't, the numbers wouldn't be counted. So you had, instead of the Advanced Research Projects Agency, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, which defended it from cuts. That's why the D was added, not any great, you know, sort of redirection of the agency. But that was really about it. I think DARPA very much was under sort of Nixon's radar of things he wanted to deal with. I don't think science and technology really occupied a lot of his time, or at least not at that granular level.
Well, I'm going to shift gears a little bit, if I may. Many who lived through the Eisenhower years, I think, tended to see him as a great general, an amiable sort of grandfatherly figure, kind of distant and removed, perhaps, and maybe even a bit of a bumbler, the garbled syntax in public, disconnected from what was going on around him, and he certainly got a bad press in his day. Talk a little bit about that, and what happened to change the perspective, the perception of him, so that he's grown in history as time has gone by.
So it's a mystery, really, a fascinating political story that Eisenhower was ever thought to be a moron and an idiot, a bumbler, and a snoozer, and a sort of rube. Because in fact, he was so intelligent. He was. This is one of the things that I really surprised me going through his papers. He was, I don't know what his IQ was, but it was very, very high. He had a just preternatural ability to digest huge amounts of complicated information and make decisions quickly. Science is one area which he loved. He invested a ton of time on DARPA, or ARPA as it was then. I love having scientists around him. He funded them. He passed legislation to the National Defense Education Act and so on. He was a very smart man. Sometimes he got tongue-tied when giving press conferences. Not the first president, or the last, who suffered that particular affliction. But during his presidency, the press, was at times very praiseworthy and liked him a lot because he was very available. He gave a weekly press conference, a weekly 30-minute live televised press conference. It was incredible. He was so available, so they liked him for that. But obviously, he hid a lot of things from the press, and they didn't like that. But the damage that was done to Eisenhower's reputation, I'm sorry to say, was done principally by Camelot. In the 1960 election, John Kennedy ran against Dwight Eisenhower, not really against Richard Nixon. He ran against an older generation. He ran against the men of that era who he felt had their turn. They'd saved us from Nazism and Japanese imperialism, but now it was time to turn to a new generation. The torch was being passed to a new generation, and that was Kennedy. But he used Eisenhower as a foil to say that those people and their generation are out of ideas. The field of ideas has withered for seven and a half years. And so Kennedy did a great deal to promote the idea of Eisenhower as an old, frail sort of figure who should no longer be in office. And his reputation never recovered, really, until we started getting into the documents of the Eisenhower Presidential Library and realizing that Eisenhower was fully engaged in running the presidency, running the country, that he was intelligent, broad-based in his interests and his capabilities. The other thing I just would say is, in the other puzzle, I mean, look at the cover of this book. Eisenhower, in color, was a magnetic figure. Everything I've read about him from the Times tells us that he was enormously charismatic. He was a great athlete as a young man, played football for Army, almost went pro as a baseball player, was just known to be a very physical man. Whenever he walked in the room, every head swiveled, and there he was, famous Eisenhower. He had a ton of charisma, piercing blue eyes, very vigorous, a red sort of florid complexion that doesn't come across in the black and white pictures of the era. So, It's odd that his reputation ever sagged as much as it did, but I think it's come back in large part because of his accomplishments, but also his style, his dignity, his sense of intense patriotism, and his lack of sort of cheap political partisanship that is just common in our politics now.
I would ask both of the presidential biographers this, but there's been quite a bit in the news lately about rankings of presidents. And
okay, I got this one.
I'm not going to ask who's at the bottom. That's not my question. My question is, how do you think each of the presidents you have written about is, each has risen, I believe, is that not correct? Where are they headed?
Well, I'll just quickly say Ike's gone up in part because of the way these polls are done. So the most recent one was a C-SPAN poll, and it put Eisenhower's fifth. That's pretty high. That's the highest he's ever been, after Washington, Lincoln, and Franklin and Teddy Roosevelt. And in part it's because the polling is done, so there are 10 questions. And they deal with, how did he handle the economy? How did he handle the Cold War? How did he handle the budget? What kind of moral figure is he? And in every one of those categories, when you ask it that way, Eisenhower always has a high mark. If you were just to poll this room, who's the fifth best president, it probably wouldn't, in your mind, maybe Ike would be in the top 10, but maybe not 5. But if you do it in these topical ways, he always comes out very highly ranked. That's why I love these polls, because it actually asks you to evaluate, well, how did he do on A, B, and C in these particular areas? And he tends to get very high marks when the polling is done that way. So that's why he's gone up.
Well, it's a little tougher for you, Jack, because as you noted, yours is the only president to resign in disgrace.
And he's done pretty well, considering. I'm sure that there are people in the presidential library in Yorba Linda who would like to get him into that top 10, but I don't ever see that happening. But he has crept up from the 40s into the 30s and into the high 20s right now. And I think it's because of two things. One, for somebody like myself, it's a shock, and yet the Vietnam experience is receding from American memory. It's being put up on a shelf with Korea as something that happened a long time ago. And China is of such importance, in our world, and the domestic accomplishments of the Nixon years have become much more valued in time. So, I mean, he certainly has a ceiling over him as the only president to resign. And it's a deserved ceiling. But I would not be at all surprised to see him in the high 20s for a while. One thing that I think is fascinating when you look at the polls of historians is that they really do rate presidents based on through the prism of the burning issue of today. So that right now, race is a burning issue in the United States, and you see people like Eisenhower, who handled the race issue in Little Rock, and Lyndon Johnson, for everything bad he did about Vietnam, soaring up into the top 15, and you see Andrew Jackson plummeting right off of the $20 bill, and even Mr. Jefferson slipping from like third to fourth or something like that. So and yet, if you go back to the 1930s when the New Deal was such an influence on American scholars, and that's when Andrew Jackson went soaring up because he was thought to be the populist forerunner of Franklin Roosevelt. So just, if there's any part of the polling you don't like, just wait 20 years from and your guys are going to go up or down.
Where do you think, you mentioned his domestic accomplishments, the Environmental Protection Agency was created under Nixon, when there was inflation, wage and price controls came into effect, which would be vigorous use of central government. Where would he figure fit in today's Republican Party?
He wouldn't. One of the things I was very leery of in writing this book was whether or not there would actually be an audience in today's polarized politics, because Nixon was that vanished breed of Northeast moderate Republicanism, even though he came from California. When a president is elected, they get to pick portraits to hang in the cabinet room of their idols. And the three ones that Nixon picked was Dwight Eisenhower, Teddy Roosevelt, and a Democrat, Woodrow Wilson. So he was definitely of the progressive strain, and not, there really is no place for him in the Republican Party today, as far as I can see.
And for Ike, well, what? Where you would fit in today's Republican Party?
Right. That's a great question, because the reason I pause is because it's a difficult one. On the one hand, I would say he wouldn't. Clearly he doesn't. He he's much too progressive in many ways. But the Republican Party of the 1950s was, let's remember, itself a very fractured party. And there was a substantial group of people called, referred to as the Old Guard, who were really significantly, I mean, they were in effect the vanguard of the Tea Party today. These were people who were extreme anti-communists, not just Joe McCarthy, but a significant number of Republican senators in the Senate who really were, I mean, I don't want to use too many pejorative terms, but they really were loony. I mean, just, they were, and Eisenhower waged a constant battle against them, and they against him. I mean, he fought his right wing vigorously, and they often got the better of him. I mean, let's remember that when Joe McCarthy was finally censured by the United States Senate, 22 Republican senators voted against the measure of censure. So there was still a block of McCarthyite opinion in the Republican Party, and it was visible in the U.S. Senate. So Eisenhower would look today, and he would say, hey, you know, politics is tough. We're divided. Some people are never Trump Republicans. Others are moderate Republicans. Others are Tea Party Republicans. It's the job of the leader of the party to try to fit it all together. And so on the one hand, he doesn't fit. On the other hand, he would say, look, it was like this in my day. We've always had difficulty with the range of opinion in the party.
So Sharon, I'm going to ask you a kind of a parallel question about DARPA. This is an agency that at various times, as you recount in your history, has been searching for a mission for itself. How does it fit? Where does it belong? What's it supposed to be doing? As you look forward from where we are now, what is the future of DARPA? What is it going to? We're in an age of asymmetrical warfare, or control of hearts and minds, perhaps more than hardware. Where do you see the agency?
I think the question is, where does the White House or the Secretary of Defense see the agency? And I think, unfortunately, they don't think about it at all. DARPA was at its best when it had a mission. And the mission under Eisenhower was very much, you know, immediately get the U.S. into space. And then it was technological superiority against the Soviet Union. And then it was, for a while, counterinsurgency. They pioneered the first nuclear test detection system, enabling the era of arms control. And these were all presidential-level missions. DARPA directors would be sort of hauled in front of Congress. They would brief presidents. It always kind of went up and down. It went down for a while, went up again under the Reagan administration. And they hit the 90s and were kind of lost as other parts of the Defense Department and the Peace Dividend and what is their role. They sort of founded again after 9/11 and were really kind of shot down. They tried to get into data mining and pattern analysis, and you know, sort of got, before the Edward Snowden revelations, they were really shot down as creating an Orwellian system. So now it's sort of a hodgepodge. They sort of talk about asymmetric warfare. They talk about creating technological surprise, whatever that means. But they do very good work today. The biggest pushback I've gotten from the book is not from previous DARPA directors, even though I'm very critical of many of them, but of current DARPA, because they want to believe what they do is important. When I say it's good, they fund good science and technology, but they've become irrelevant in many ways to either the White House or to senior Pentagon leaders. And the problem with that is that it becomes very easy, if you have one major screw-up, which all agencies do, for people to kind of swoop in and take your budget. They are very much a solution in search of a problem these days. And that's their challenge going forward.
I'm going to turn now to questions from the audience. Please raise your hand, and we'll get a microphone to you. Yes, ma'am, right here. A microphone is coming to you.
Probably don't need one.
You do for television.
Oh, right. Okay. Sorry. Thank you. First, thank you all for a fascinating discussion. My question is for Sharon, and I don't even really know where to start. My father spent the year 1959 in Vietnam as an advisor. Then we were sent to Edgewood Chemical Arsenal for 3 years, where LSD tests were done and so on, and then he ended up being the Inspector General for the Test and Evaluation Command in Aberdeen Proving Grounds. To what, and someone said, you need to know what DARPA is. To what extent would DARPA have been driving the chemical testing in the early 60s, the testing defoliants and all of that kind of thing. I'm just curious. I have a lot of research to do, but I'm curious to know what DARPA's mission was in that period of time.
Well, actually, this is a fascinating history. So I want to be careful saying that DARPA was responsible for all things. So certainly Aberdeen had its own work, and the work that you referenced with chemical hallucinogenics is its own history. So what DARPA was very involved with, and this is something that they've desperately tried to forget about. They like to joke about their failures, but this is a failure they don't talk about. They pioneered the first experiments with chemical defoliation in Vietnam. They brought what were called the rainbow agents, because we now associate chemical defoliation with Agent Orange, because Agent Orange was the most widely used in Vietnam, but in fact there was Agent Purple and Agent Orange and another few, I forget which colors there were. I think there were four or five different agents, which were just different chemical configurations. And then DARPA said, yeah, we did that, but it wasn't a big deal. Well, look, I went through the archives. They had a chemical defoliation office up through 1968 that was pretty heavily staffed. They did studies. They equipped the first aircraft. The Air Force eventually took over the operational program, but this was through and through a DARPA operation. And when I tell people, it's like you don't need to do it to humiliate the agency's record, but if you want to talk about successes, then the failures are not free. There is DARPA invented ARPANET that became Internet, but it also was responsible for introducing chemical defoliation to Vietnam, and you have to look at the impact of both the success and failures. So yes, DARPA has a whole history with chemical defoliation. A lot of the other work at Aberdeen they may have overlapped with, but was also very had its own history. Go to the National Archives at College Park.
That's where we're headed next. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Beck.
Thank you. I also am thoroughly enjoying your panel discussion. This is a lighter question, Jack. My question is, what, if any, impact did the opera, Adams' opera, Nixon in China, have on his reputation?
I think it probably helped it. It was one of the first sort of counter arguments to the caricature. It got beyond the Tricky Dick persona. It showed that he had ideals. Some amazing dances with he and Kissinger and the Air Force One coming in. And I'm surprised that we haven't seen it revived more consistently. I'm not a music critic, so perhaps there's something in the music that's not great about it. But as far as a piece of Americana, I think it's a spectacular production. Yeah. Thank
you. Other questions? Yes, sir. Microphone is coming to you, making its way.
I have a question for Professor Hitchcock. I grew up in the 50s, and I remember saluting Ike with a glass of milk in my schoolroom in Boston when there was a television program in the morning, and we were all supposed to salute the president. But anyway, I also grew up, as some people in this room did, under the reign of fear, not unlike the fear that came after 9/11, where it was inculcated in us that at any moment Soviet rockets could be raining down upon us, and in our public library they handed out cards, little wallet cards, explaining to you what the different sirens would mean. If you heard three long blasts, that meant that an attack was probable, get home. If you heard three short blasts, that meant attack imminent, take cover immediately. To what extent do you think that Eisenhower was part of promoting or promulgating this sense of fear of imminent communist attack, which I so vividly remember?
He was central to it. And I say that not necessarily to criticize, but simply to say that Eisenhower embraced this problem. And he referred to the fact that, quote unquote, we live in an age of peril. He used that term publicly all the time. He was terrified of the prospect that there might be a nuclear exchange in the 1950s. I mean, when he came into office, even before he was inaugurated, he was briefed on the development of the hydrogen bomb. And, you know, he's sitting in his, he was in Augusta, and he gets a visit from the Atomic Energy Commission secretary to say, well, we've just had done yet another explosion, and we can tell you now that the H-bomb that we've just tested on in the Pacific has been a success, and here's the size of it, here's the scale of it, here's the epic dimensions of this thing. This is just as he's entering into his, into his presidency. And throughout his 8 years in office, the United States would continue to develop and expand those nuclear weapons. So, as a military man, Eisenhower felt that these were weapons that he wanted to have, it's chilling, but he wanted to have them available to use if necessary. He thought that by developing them, it would become likely that you would never have to use them because they would be so overwhelming as to deter the Soviets from ever striking the United States. But the amount of money that was spent on developing the nuclear deterrent was enormous, but also the power of the nuclear deterrent was terrifying. So Eisenhower often spoke with his advisors about how do we tell the public how dangerous all this stuff is without scaring them into a panic. And he debated this a lot. He gave a number of public speeches that were designed to answer this question, which was, things are really bad, but don't panic. And I can tell you, they weren't very effective. Because, of course, as the capabilities grew, most people began to fear them, but also living in a state of constant panic is exhausting. So there was a sense that it almost became comic. You know, the duck and cover movies that you probably have seen where you have a little turtle walking down the street. When the bomb comes, remember, duck and cover. They turned it into a kind of a caricature, a game almost. And that's a way of domesticating that fear, making it seem accessible and manageable. So we have both the reality of the fear, but we also have a way of sort of making it seem kind of comic and almost curiously charming. And those are both elements of this paradoxical decade of the 50s.
I bet I'm not the only person in this room who remembers getting under my desk in school. Another question over here. Yes, sir.
Now, this is sort of a follow-up to Clark's last question to Sharon. To what extent do you think DARPA has become increasingly irrelevant because it basically built its own successor in the terms of Silicon Valley that has proven that the private sector can do this stuff more effectively than the government?
That's a great point, and it's one that DARPA talks about today. So for perspective, when DARPA basically pioneered computer networking, ARPANET that led to the internet, and more broadly the funding of the first computer science departments in the 1960s, they were the game in town. There really wasn't anybody else funding it. They could create the direction of computer science in this country, and they did. In the 1980s, they went back into it less successfully with the Strategic Computing Initiative, which was an effort that failed to build artificial intelligence. But lo and behold, the generation of graduate students that funded are the ones out in Silicon Valley. DARPA takes some credit, along with the NSA, of saving Steve Jobs' prior company. Was it called his venture before, when he was between Apple?
Yeah.
Basically, it was about to go out of business, and NSA and DARPA bought some machine equipment. Yes, absolutely, you're right. And so, but now, what DARPA spends in computer science, which it is trying to still make an impact on, it's minuscule. But I don't think that's the biggest problem that DARPA faces in terms of irrelevance. And it's not DARPA's fault. In general, there's been a transformation of the relationship between the Pentagon and the science and technology community that actually goes beyond DARPA, sort of a downgrading. It used to be that sort of the chief technologist, the director of defense research and engineering, was the number three position in the Pentagon. Now it's fallen well below that in the hierarchy. They're trying to redo it now. You know, Eisenhower, for example, he really relied on his scientific advisors on creating DARPA, on creating a NASA, on which direction to go in. Scientists don't have that sort of influence on the administration. This predates the current administration. I just don't think science advisors have been as important in recent years. So the big question is, if DARPA is to be important again, someone in the White House or at the top of the Pentagon leadership has to decide, we have this problem, and we need DARPA to solve it. In the Iraq war and Afghanistan war, when roadside bombs, improvised explosive devices, started to become a big problem, they created a new agency and spent billions of dollars. Because people said, well, that's not really, DARPA doesn't do that. They do future science and technology. And that's completely untrue. In the Vietnam War, they were the counterinsurgency agency. DARPA could have taken on the roadside bomb mission, but it sort of recreated itself as like a futuristic science fiction version of itself. Mm-hmm. So someone has to decide DARPA is the agency to solve our problems, and that has to come from above them.
Mm-hmm. Two more questions there, and I believe you had one, sir, and then we'll wind up.
Thank you. Sharon, I've read your book, and I love it.
Thank you.
And I have some of your other ones, too, and we'll continue reading. I'm going to address my question about the president. So when you were talking about Robert Dole losing an important function, I thought you were talking about his Viagra, which many of us were known for. And Eisenhower had a famous affair with his driver, was it? And, of course, the revelations about Kennedy and LBJ and some of the other presidents, and now with our current situation with the payoffs and such, I'm curious, was Nixon really as straight as his reputation leads us to believe?
There are some indications that in his own awkward way, he would reach out to other women when things got very tense at home. Pat Nixon, you should go to the dictionary and look up long-suffering, there should be Pat Nixon's picture. But she was one of the biggest surprises in doing this life was how much I came to like Pat Nixon. She had a wonderful, sarcastic sense of humor. There was a piece in Bob Woodward's latest book about Nixon on a helicopter ride coming back from Camp David and reaching out and just putting his hand on the knee or the thigh of one of his secretaries. And it was, the way it's made sound is not like a Harvey Weinstein. It sounds much more like just somebody wanting to get some kind of human contact into his life. But there was one alleged mistress that he had, and the relationship was serious enough that the CIA investigated it because she was a Hong Kong hostess at like the Hong Kong Hilton, and they worried that she might have been an agent for the Red Chinese. So you actually have a CIA investigation of, he was not president at the time, of Richard Nixon and a subsequent leak to the New York Times, surprise, surprise. And a story in the New York Times saying, you know, Nixon cleared of having an affair with a Red Chinese spy. So the bottom line is that he did have this basic awkwardness with all human contact. And I think that probably his sexuality or sexual relations with women throughout his life reflected that to some extent.
Yes, sir.
So I've encountered DARPA in my day job from time to time, and to me they are somewhat the epitome of the military-industrial complex. So Ike makes his famous speech about beware of the military-industrial complex. At the same time, I've heard you argue that he had a lot to do in 8 years of building up the Defense Department. Can you talk about the context of that speech, and did he have a change of heart?
No, thank you. It's a great question. I read the speech a little bit differently than a prophetic speech about, oh my goodness, if we keep going in this direction, we'll end up with a military-industrial complex. That'll be terrible. What he says is, in the speech, we have had to create a military-industrial complex. That's done. Check. We did that. And we did it because we live in an age of peril. We live in an age when we have real enemies who want to do us harm, and we need to build up our defense capabilities. But then he went on in the speech to say, all right, we've got this thing. Now it is incumbent upon you as the citizens, but especially upon people like me as political leaders, to control it. We have to keep it tightly monitored. We have to guard against the unwarranted influence of the military-industrial complex in our politics, in our press, in the Congress, in the way we spend money. And who can do that? What kind of leaders can do that? Well, leaders like Dwight D. Eisenhower. That was the point of the speech, which was essentially, I know how to contain the military-industrial complex. I created it, and those guys are afraid of me, and I can say no to the generals. But the guy we just elected, John Kennedy, 43 years old, lieutenant junior grade, might not be the kind of guy who can control the military-industrial complex. I think it's a warning, which is, he was very angry about the results of the election. And he felt that maybe Kennedy's generation, which had scorned Eisenhower's generation, wasn't going to be strong enough to control and contain the military-industrial complex. So in that sense, I think it's a political message, which is, you got to elect tough people if you want to be safe and secure. And control the powers of this beast that we've created. So I actually think it's a fascinating and rather complex message that he sends in that farewell address, which he gave just a few days before leaving office.
I would say that, Sharon, if you'll forgive me, the DARPA that I read profiled in your book is hardly the disciplined military-industrial complex that comes to mind when we use that phrase. And I've told you my favorite factoid out of the book is a man from McDonald's, the hamburger company, calls the Pentagon with an idea because he figures out how to wrap food more sanitarily. And he just gets passed around until someone at DARPA takes the call. And he only takes the call because he misunderstood and he thought the man worked for McDonnell Douglas. And the kicker is, DARPA hired him.
They did. He would have been right here, office director. Now, so there's two points about that. First, it's funny, when they created DARPA in 1958, one of the sort of jokes about it was like, all these nutcases were coming to you, calling Pentagon officials, I know how to stop a Soviet attack, I can design a missile shield. And so their joke was, oh, we finally have a place to like send the, you know, the nuts. We're gonna get this new agency, and they would. But actually, that exists till today. Literally, if someone, you know, there are these people who will call around to different offices in the Pentagon, and they will still sort of send them over to DARPA. I actually want to make one more. I came away from the research on the book very impressed with Eisenhower and how much he thought about the issues of science and technology, of the psychological aspects of the technological race with the Soviet Union, as well as the scientific aspects. And the way he listened to this debate between the science advisors who were advising him one way and sometimes agreed with him, sometimes didn't, and the people in the Pentagon were often advising him in another way. And he didn't always go one way or the other. And I really came away very impressed with sort of his mastery of not just the science, but also of the psychological aspects.
Yeah, and I had to fight to keep more Eisenhower out of my book. I mean, as I do the
I'm
research.
Taking care of all that.
There they go. Amazing, amazing American hero.
Well, I have a feeling this discussion could go on for quite a while, but we do need to wrap it up to allow time for you to buy books and the authors to sign them for you. I want to thank everyone for coming today. This has been a fascinating discussion from three terrific authors. And please complete the evaluation forms, either online or in paper. And we have books up front that are for sale and available for signing. So thank you all very much.